it going? What is up? Welcome to One by One. It's episode number 39, and damn, I got another cool one, man. It's getting pretty fucking awesome to be able to talk to some cool motherfuckers. You know, 10 years ago, this wouldn't have been able to happen exactly how it is right now. Not only because the podcast thing was like just happening, but for me in particular, just being able to like contact somebody so easily, it's pretty fucking awesome. So, this week it's a doozy. It's a motherfucking doozy. You might be able to guess who it is, besides looking at the name on the thing that you're probably listening to. But you might not. I don't know what I'm talking about. I'm a little delusional. I've been up for a while today, and that's no excuse. It's just a reason. Reasons are for losers, because nothing gets done. I'm getting excited because there's only a few weeks left until I get to meet my son, and it's getting a little easier every time I talk about it to talk about it. It's very cool. But my lady is about to burst, and she still has about 10 or 11 more days of work before she's out on maternity leave. She's taking like the week before she's due, so I hope that she gets it. I want to meet him, really want to meet him, but if she can get that one week that she can just try to relax, and get whatever she thinks she needs to get done, that'd be awesome. We just had our baby shower last weekend. I can't even thank my friends and family enough for that. We basically don't need anything. Except for bottles. But, wow. We were just sitting here talking about it, and we were both almost like brought to tears. Like, it's crazy. Like, I've had some times in my life where, I don't know, I've been down. Some shit has, you know, just like in everybody's life, shit has gone down and was not really in too good of a place for a while there, and a bunch of different things helped. My family, first and foremost, they've always been there for me, and I just want to be able to be there for them too. It's kind of what has been driving me to do this thing, the podcast and design, and just doing something else that I love, that I hope will get me to somewhere where I'm financially stable enough to support me and my family. I want to be able to help my parents out like they helped me out, and my brothers and everybody that I love. And I don't know, just thinking about the times that I was down, some of the reasons for me being that way were not dumb, but I just wasn't looking at the big picture, you know? And when something like this, like a baby shower happens, and you get shown how much you are loved, I know it's a weird way to be shown, but in gifts, but it's for the baby. It's incredible. I just hope that I can continue to, you know, get better at what I do and be able to provide that kind of love and support for my friends and family that will be in my situation in the future. So thank you to everybody. And I know that 99% of them, probably almost 100% of them, will never hear this, but I love you all and thank you. It's really great. Our apartment is just packed full of baby shit right now. Some of it I gotta put together and some of it I gotta we just gotta organize. So it is really, really fucking awesome. So sorry for the long little boring sentimental intro here, but I felt like I need to get that out. And just let you know that I'm a real dude going through some real shit right now. And, you know, I'm not, I don't know, I'm not claiming to be anything, but I do know that if you want something, you gotta go for it. And don't let anything stop you. Don't give in to that resistance. Resistance is a bitch. I've been reading listening to The War of Art by Stephen Pressfield. Because Joe Rogan and Joey Diaz keep talking about it, and, I went back and listened to the podcast, the JRE with Stephen Pressfield on it when they were talking about it. And I actually want to go back and listen to it again for a third time after I get done listening to the book, because I got the audio book on iTunes. But so far, one of my favorite lines, besides all the talk about resistance, I forget exactly who he's talking about, but he said, RIP, motherfucker. That just stuck out to me. I don't know why. But rest in peace, resistance. Anyway, this week is a special episode. I got this guy on here that I'm so lucky, man. I'm so fucking lucky. I would not have gotten the opportunity to talk to this guy if I don't work with the people that I work with, I think, and, you know, do the photoshops and posters that I do. And it's really cool to be able to connect with somebody like-minded and, you know, into the same kind of stuff that you're into, because I've been into photography forever. I took a couple classes in high school and I just never continued. You know, I was always an amateur photographer. I never went professional. But you know, this guy is one of the best that I have ever seen. And he's taking pictures of legends right now. The comedy scene in Los Angeles is on fucking fire. And he's right in there. And he's mostly invisible to people that are around when he's taking his pictures. But that's because he wants to be. And you'll hear all about that, including a story about a photographer friend of his that kind of got caught by Bill Burr. I would not want to have been that dude. But it's really cool. He's friends with Joey Diaz and a bunch of comedians. He used to be a comedian himself. He still is. But he just has so much other shit going on that he doesn't have as much time for it as he would like. And who knows? Maybe he'll continue to pursue that route if something else comes up. But it was an honor and a pleasure to have him on, and I'm just still in awe that we just got off the Skype call, and had that cool fucking conversation that you're about to hear. So thank you for listening, and enjoy, ladies and gentlemen, the great and powerful Troy Conrad. Troy?
Mike.
What's going on, brother?
Hey, not too much. Hey, I want to make sure this is good, clean audio. We sounding good here?
Yeah, it sounds great to me, man.
All right, right on.
Thank you
very
much.
Good to be with you, man.
Thank you for giving me some of your time, dude. It's an honor. Thanks.
Oh, dude, I love the stuff you're doing, man. I'm really, I'm glad to do it.
Oh, thanks, dude.
You're doing such cool stuff, man. It's just, it's really great.
Thank you very much. It's fun, dude. I have a day job, obviously, but like it's just something I do at night now. You know, I come home and I do it during the day too. I say fuck it, I'll go on a fucking break at work and finish up something real quick because I do a lot of it on my phone.
Yeah, man, that's what it's about. That's you do that on your phone.
Yeah, like 99% of it I do on my iPhone 6 Plus.
Oh, that's great, man. I mean, I love when people are doing creative stuff, and yeah, we all got to have our things to survive and our jobs to survive. But you know, we do it long enough, and eventually, the thing that you love to do most is the thing that you get to do. You just have to keep doing it every single day and get better and better. You know?
Yeah, practice makes perfect, I guess. Not really absolutely perfect. Some of the shit I make, I'm like, what the fuck is this?
Yeah, yeah. No, I mean, that's what, and by the way, that's what I, like, everything that I've learned, I've always succeeded from most from my mistakes. Like, that's really what it's about. And I think comics are the same way. Like, you know, even in, I don't have as much time now for stand-up, but, you know, having a bad set can be more instructive than having a month long of great sets.
Yeah. Yeah, you learn a lot more from it, I would assume, you know.
Yeah, you learn a lot when you go home and you're like, oh man, I feel like shit right now. But like you go home and you start writing. I remember when I did this club. This is in the 90s in Sacramento.
Yeah.
And the club owner, I think I was only a year in or something. And you know, I was trying to get gigs that were maybe. I was stretching a little bit because I wanted to push myself. Yeah. And I work in this club, and the owner comes up afterwards. He goes, hey man, he goes, you don't have half an hour. And I go, what are you talking about? I just did half an hour. He goes, oh yeah, yeah, you did half an hour, but you don't have half an hour.
It's like a low blow.
Oh yeah. No, I felt terrible. And you know, and I'm a new comic and I'm wanting to, you know, I'm in my mind, I want it to be perfect, and this is a new club, and this is like one of my first weeks at a comedy club, and the guy, he goes, yeah, man, he goes, I'm not gonna even keep you around unless I see something. So I went home that night. I'll never forget. I hardly even slept, man. I just started writing stuff, and it all worked out. You know, I ended up having a great rest of the week, and the guy, at the end of the week, he gave me a piece of paper with three dates on it for the next 12 months.
Oh, that's awesome.
You know, but like that's such a helpful thing, you know, to learn from your mistakes.
Yeah, and to be able to accept like constructive criticism too, unless the person that's telling you is actually being a fucking dick, you know. Then it's kind of like, what the hell? Maybe I shouldn't listen to that particular comment. No.
Right, right. Yeah, you have to take everything with a grain of salt. You can't let people influence, you know, you can't let people influence what you're doing creatively, but if you have people that you trust and people that have been, you know, people that you respect artistically.
Yeah.
And I think people should go to them for feedback. Like you should go to them first, right? Like there's people I trust. I always check in. I'll, hey man, can you tell me, what do you think about this bit? Or I'll leave them a voicemail and say, tell me what you think about this.
Yeah.
But someone that comes up to you drunk after a show, that's not going to be the person you want to listen to.
Yeah. I was talking, I don't know, you probably know who I'm talking about. The graphic designer for The Fighter and the Kid, Drastic Graphics, his name's Marty O'Neill. I had him on the podcast a couple, like a month or two ago, and he was telling me that one of his favorite like persons to go to see whether or not one of his designs is like got a good reaction or whatever is his daughter, his like little daughter. He'll show her something, and if she's like, "What is that?" He'll be like, "Okay, right. Even a little kid can't even understand this. Maybe I should fix it up a little bit."
Right, right. Kids are honest, so yeah, as long as you know, as long as there's not like some reference in there, a kid's not going to get, you know, kids will tell you. But as we get older, you know, we just start getting. There's just so much of a bullshit game sometimes, you know, where everybody wants to pretend everything's cool and, you know,
yeah. Like, and it seems like sometimes they want to get, they want to maybe say something to you just, you know, because they're jealous of you, you know, you got to like watch out for that crap too.
Yeah. When I was, yeah, that's true. That's true. There are people, but you know, those aren't the people you're going to seek out, right?
Oh, no. Those are the people that are coming up to you randomly.
Yeah, those are people that are trying to kind of haze you or whatever, and that has its value too, because you have to get through that.
Yeah.
Like when I hear about these guys who are making it on YouTube, right? Like there's these people that have gotten so big on YouTube that, you know, they can get gigs at comedy clubs because they can draw people, and it's not a great thing for stand-up, but it's still a reality.
Yeah.
One, you know, and a good example, by the way, of a really a successful and funny guy who started that way is Bo Burnham. But, you know, the amount of hazing that guy had to put up with on YouTube of everybody hating on him.
I can imagine. He's a young dude, too.
Yeah, young guy. And, like, I always wonder, how did that not just, like, get to his core? And the answer came to me. I was watching, someone asked a similar question about Natasha Leggero. Someone asked her on a show one time, like, "Hey, does it bother you? You get a lot of hateful comments." And she's like, "Oh no, I always assume that it's like some hormone poisoned 11-year-old. So why would that bother me?"
Yeah, really? You gotta treat it that way, at least, you know,
you have to treat it that way. That's exactly right. Like whether that's true or not, certainly it's not somebody you respect that's leaving like hating comments. Like those people are just, they're idiots, and you know, they're not there to help you. They're there because they're frustrated that they haven't followed or pursued anything that they really love.
Exactly. And once you get to Joey Diaz's status, you probably watch him sometimes on Twitter. He goes off on some people that fucking say some stupid shit. It's hilarious.
Yeah. I love it. And they probably shut up after that, after seeing that Uncle Joey took him down, because if he's mocking somebody or messing with somebody who's a hater, they deserve it because he doesn't have time.
Yeah, man. And he's full of love, man. Like
he may
look like he's a little tough on the outside, but it's all love in there. It's like a big teddy bear.
Anybody that really listens to him, like you find out that he's pure love, you know, and like, sometimes people are like a little prickly and cactusy on the outside, but inside they're just like, they are, they're teddy bears, you know?
Yeah.
Just Doug Stanhope is the same way. Like people think that he's this like kind of brash, angry, whatever. He's like one of the most sweet, tender, vulnerable human beings. And that's why people love him. Not because he's this guy being tough, or he just is who he is. But deep down, he's a very sweet, sweet human being, and I think that's how people connect to him now.
Yeah, that's just that's his humor. That's like what he finds funny, I would assume. Like part of it, you know, part of comedy has to be making yourself laugh. I would think, you know.
Oh yeah, no, he's my favorite. You know? I mean, he's as dark as it gets, and he never misses on making that dark funny. And that's, I think, such a big challenge, because sometimes you can be dark and you can get lost in the dark.
Yeah, people are like, "What the hell did I just watch?"
and you know, after you've watched a lot of comedy, you don't get as excited about hearing like a lot of mainstream comedy and stuff. So so for people who've like sort of been through everybody in comedy, people like Joey and Stanhope and Rogan, those guys are always putting out new stuff. And that's why there's such an appeal.
Yeah.
Like that's the real. That's where things get real.
Hell yeah! Now you started out in comedy before photography. Is that true?
Yeah. I love, by the way, when people just know me as a photographer.
Well, because I did my research too, but I mean, I've been following you for a couple of years now just because the whole comedy scene, and I see your pictures fucking everywhere. They're incredible. And that's why I thank you so much for even taking the time to talk to me. But
thank you, man. Thank you. I appreciate that. Well, I'll tell you what. I started in the 90s, in the mid-90s in stand-up and early mid-90s. And then I came out to L.A. like 14 years ago. I started a show 6 years ago called Set List. Paul Provenza and I partnered on the show, and we've been taken around the world. We're actually in London at the Soho Theater this weekend. We do it, you know, we're like 2 months, usually a month or two in Australia every year. We're in Edinburgh for the Edinburgh Fringe Festival every year for the whole month of August. We're all over the place with the show. We've done it in, I want to say it's like 11 countries now.
Wow.
And that's such a, that show, it's an amazing show, but it also takes so much time. So I don't have a lot of time for stand-up. I have some spots this week, but it's not something I get to do a lot because my time is devoted to Set List and to my photography, which also started when I needed to take good pictures for Set List. So
really,
October will be 7 years of the show, and that's, I've always done photography, but I never went pro until I started taking really good, challenging myself, taking these low light pictures on stage, which is, if you've ever tried to take a picture at a comedy club with your phone, hey, good luck.
I have a couple on Instagram. They're pretty horrible.
Anybody that, like, that's where you start learning, this great, amazing camera, like the iPhone, it's an unbelievable camera, but you better have light.
Yeah.
Because you're never going to get away with taking a really good onstage picture. Once in a while, you might get lucky, but there's just not enough light for a phone sensor to work on that. Yeah. Now, in 5 years, that'll change probably. But
yeah, I'm sure they'll have some like adaption. Don't iPhones have like little lenses? There's like very few, but there are some.
They do. they do. And but you can't go better than the, like, you can't get a better aperture than the one that's on the camera itself.
Right? I got you. Yeah.
So it's tricky. Go ahead.
No, I'm sorry.
Like you with lenses, like lenses are always more important than the camera, and they are getting better and better on these phones.
Yeah, I have one that's like, it turns it into like the fisheye look, and like one that zooms in. It's pretty crap though, you know.
Yeah,
like, but compared to a real camera.
If you have plenty of light, it's an unbelievable camera. I mean, I'm blown away when like sometimes I'll see people, they'll show me stuff they did on their phone. I'm like, wow, that's incredible. Like, they, like we're at the point now where a mirrorless camera or a DSLR is neck and neck with an iPhone 7 for landscape stuff.
Yeah, it's crazy.
I mean, they're absolutely neck and neck. Like, they're so good now. But, you know, again, I focus on a lot of low light stuff, and that's my thing. And that's you have to have a good lens and a good camera for that to happen. Mostly a good lens.
Yeah, I've been watching Instagram, like, since Instagram started, you could see like the progression of like iPhone 3G or whatever, all the way up to the current models, because all the people's pictures just keep getting better and better, like more clear, you know.
Oh, totally, man. Yeah, like it's so weird. Like, when I started on YouTube, I was an early adapter to YouTube, and I no longer am active on it now, but I was building it up quite a bit, and all my videos are still in like 4:3. Like, it was at a time when it was a big deal to upload like a 480p video. Like, that took a while. Everybody had dial up, and you know what I mean?
Yeah, now it's 1080, like right from your friggin' phone.
Yeah, you could I think you could do 4K on Vimeo now. Like, it's incredible. I love it. I love all of it. Anytime someone gets upset about the changes, the rapid changes in technology, because it does disrupt, Even if it disrupts me, I like it because it's an advancement. And that's what it's about.
And it's a and it's a learn. Like, you get to learn more, like, as time goes on, you know?
Every day I try to learn something new about photography, whether that's an like reading an article or learning from some mensch who posts on YouTube who shows me how to do something that that's a, like a really challenging thing. And that's one of the ways that I've gotten better. And the thing is that that's still underused. People can do that with anything, like whether they want to improve in whatever creative thing they're doing or their job or as a human being, you can just fucking put that into YouTube. Like, I don't know if this will work, but type in how to be a better human being.
I'm sure there's a few videos on it.
Everybody should just do that in the morning. Type that into YouTube and just start your day with that.
Yeah, dude. I mean, besides like listening to other podcasters and shit, I learned how to do the podcast thing from watching YouTube videos, like the technical side of it, you know?
Yeah.
So
yeah,
you can learn anything on there.
that's exactly the point. Is whatever you want to do, it's out there. You know, if you wanted to, like, it's never that there's not enough stuff out there to learn from. It's that people just don't, people give in to that resistance, you know?
Mm-hmm.
And everybody knows how to, like, have the body they want. Everybody knows that on paper. But not everybody goes to the gym and does the diet stuff and everything they need to do just because they give in to that resistance, or they go, oh, I got something else, or they give it up easy. But everyone knows how to do it.
Yeah.
You know, it's not a matter of knowledge anymore. It's a matter of willpower and self-discipline and habit.
And getting over that resistance, that fucking, the war of art.
Yeah, exactly. And I loved it. I didn't even know. I heard Joey recently, I think like 2 months ago, talk about it. And I was like, I didn't even know Joey was into that stuff. Like the war of art, he had a whole episode, like he did a whole podcast on it.
Yeah.
And that book is fantastic. I'm really into Seth Godin. I was lucky enough to study with him a year and a half ago. And I like him even more than the Stephen Pressfield stuff, like the war of art. Seth Godin wrote a book called The Dip, and that was like the big life changer for me.
Oh yeah, I'll have to check it out because I just downloaded the War of Art one, and like I'm still like listening to it. I don't even have time to read.
Oh yeah, man, dude, check out. As a matter of fact,
I'll write it down right now.
Maybe the best thing I ever watched is and that led me to starting Set List and starting a whole bunch of projects and films and everything else. It's called Quieting the Lizard Brain. It's a video you can find on Vimeo or YouTube. If you type Quieting the Lizard Brain, you just into Google, you'll find it. And it's like probably a 7-minute video. And if that doesn't change your life and get you more focused on what you want to do, then I don't know what to tell you, because that's an unbelievable video.
Oh, I'm going to look it up and then I will get back to you on that.
Yeah, man, I want to hear back.
Not that I like need motivation. It's just, I don't know. I feel like I'm just like tired a lot, you know?
Yeah. No, totally. Right. Tired is right. Everybody gets like those reasons, right? There's always like, we're tired, we don't have the time, but when you want it bad enough, it you'll work it out. Right. So like, it's not a matter, like you said, oh, it's not that, it's not motivation that we need necessarily. Right.
Yeah. Cause I feel that I want to do shit.
Yeah. It's motivation is like, it's like now it's an external thing that we think, oh, motivation will get me through it. I just got to go out there and find it. And you know, that's not real. Like you have to create it. So you have to, like, if you want to start a blog, you don't wait for the motivation to start a blog. You just write your blog and you write it the next day and then the next day. And now you have 3 days worth of habit. Those are 3 habit credits. The more credits you get, like, that just becomes something you do.
Yeah. Yeah, I totally feel it, man. It's a weird thing, the whole art life, you know, like How did you get it started with the photography then? Was it comedy? Or because I was looking at your website and I was seeing all the stuff that you have on there, and you do like band photography and like stuff like that once in a while too. Like,
yeah, more than half of what I do is portraits and headshots and publicity stills for comics and actors. Mm-hmm. I sort of, instead of just doing headshots, like I found out everyone has a camera now, right?
Yeah.
And so many, like everyone has a camera obviously with their phone, but also a billion people have DSLRs and mirrorless cameras, right? So I have to account for that, and I have to set myself apart. Every artist has to set themselves apart in some way.
Yeah.
So what I do is I get everyone, I do publicity stills, I do social media stuff, I do stuff with their website. I shoot a whole range of things so that they have more than just a headshot that they put down on a desk. Like that's sort of outdated, I feel like, to shoot just that. Like people need more now. So that's what I do. And it all did start from I was in – I remember the first year that Setlist early on, it went to Edinburgh, and I just kept, I had so many challenges trying to shoot. We were actually in a cave, a real cave, like where, where people died from the plague, like 500 years ago or whatever.
Oh, wow.
And obviously like the light gets just sucked in and absorbed in a cave. Like it's not like a room with a stage. It's just different. Mm-hmm. So I kept finding challenges and then finding a way to get better and better at it. And that's how I started, is from shooting live shows. And so the rest of the stuff I shoot now, it's like, yeah, I do a lot of the headshots, portrait stuff, but I do, live comedy, live music. And, I love doing that stuff, man. I try to always get stuff. Well, I've made it a habit to get stuff that's different than what would normally be there.
Yeah, some of your shots, man. Honestly, I feel like you have a video recorder with more than 4K, and you're just like picking the best. You know what I mean? Like you take
that's nice.
The actual shots are just perfect. It's crazy.
Wow, thank you. Thank you. I appreciate that. It's something I love doing. I just found out today a really trippy thing that there was an article on a photography site about MySpace Tom.
Yeah, I saw that, but I didn't read it.
Oh, like, yeah. You saw.
Like, what's he doing now or something?
Yeah, he's a photographer now.
Oh, no shit.
He's a pro photographer, and he's really good at it. Like, he does some really cool, like, landscape stuff. And so I think he's on Instagram as MySpace Tom or something like that. And he's like legit good. And he got good at it. Like that's what he retired from MySpace, and that's what he went into.
Yeah. He's going to have to work, I'm sure.
Right. Yeah, he sold the company for, I don't know, whatever it was, like 600 million or some crazy amount. So that'll get you some good lenses, you know.
Yeah, a couple of them.
Yeah, it'll get a couple good ones. So that guy's doing really cool stuff, and what a great thing, right? I mean, what do you do awesome. When you're fucking, like, what was he, like, probably 28 years old or something, and now has all this money? You better go into something creative, or else you're going to end up like a Jersey Shore douchebag or something, you know?
Oh,
like,
my God.
Just wasting money and, like, living for just, you know, the weekends and just beer, just stupid shit. Oh, it's so whether you have money or not, you're always better off going into what you love.
Hell yeah. I was asking about the band photography stuff, because that's when I first started doing like these semi Photoshop. It wasn't really, I was using Photoshop. I have a couple friends around my area. I live in Jersey, like kind of near, like 20 minutes from Philly. And
okay.
I have a couple friends that do like live music photography. And I would take their shots, like they would take like individual shots of each person in the band as they were playing, you know, and then I would take them and kind of Photoshop them out of that picture and put like some other kind of background behind it and put them all together in one frame, you know. Uh-huh. Like, so I was,
oh, no.
I don't know, do you have fun doing like music stuff as much as comedy?
Oh, dude, I love it, man. I love it. I'll tell you a funny story. I love it because, like, I know how to shoot comedy. One thing I'm really careful about is, one of the best compliments someone told me recently, someone was like, hey, I never see, like, when you're photographing, you're kind of invisible. Yeah. And I was like, yeah, that's what I want to be. Like, I like being invisible. And when I'm shooting, even if I have to walk on stage behind a comic, I feel like nobody's paying attention to me because they see that I'm taking a picture and I'm invisible. Like, I just tell myself that. So that way I don't have to worry about it. But I do stay out of the way of sight lines of comics. So I'll tell you a funny story. I was shooting Dean Del Rey had this amazing show, where his birthday show last year, where he had all these great comics, and then he had these insanely like legendary musicians, and they all played the entire Back in Black AC/DC album from beginning to end.
Wow. I remember the show, but I didn't know that happened.
Oh, man, it was so cool. So Bill Burr's on stage. Well, let me back up. So there was another photographer, really good guy and really like solid photographer, but he hadn't shot a lot of comedy. Mm-hmm. Like he had shot all kinds of stuff. And, you know, bands, if you're shooting a band and you're close up, they're not going to stop in the middle of the song and be like, hey, man, you're too close. They're doing their thing. But if you're shooting a comedian and you're like getting too close to them, like near the front of the stage, they might be a little annoyed.
Yeah. So
I told this guy, I was like, hey, I said, just kind of a tip. I said, definitely stay out of the sight lines of the comics. I said, because it can be a little distracting for comics. So make sure you're in the dark so that you're not like up close. I know it's easier to get the shot if you get up close, but then they're going to see you. So, and this guy goes, oh yeah, that's a good idea. But he didn't listen to me.
Oh.
So Bill Burr's on stage, man. And it's like worst case scenario. Bill's on stage and this guy, I see him like he's in the third row and he's right in the light and he's clicking away. And Bill Burr, it was so funny. He goes, he's like, dude, enough with the photos already. He's like, what is this for your hometown newspaper that doesn't exist? And he starts laying into the guy. And I was just like, oh man, this poor guy, like literally it was like 500-600 people there. And this guy was the center of everything. And that's a nightmare for me. Cause I don't want anybody to point me out I want to be invisible and just a guy who just pops in and then I'm in everybody's peripheral vision, but they're not focused on me. Yeah. It was crazy.
You get the shot and you get the fuck out of there, you know?
Yeah. Yeah. You get out of there. You work it out with your lens or you crop in later or whatever, but don't get in front of Bill Burr of all things.
Fuck that.
Flicking away. Cause he's going to call it out. He's a guy who's so comfortable. He's always in the moment. So if he's annoyed by something, he's going to say it. And everybody who's watched the YouTube, Bill Burr in Philly knows that.
Oh yeah, I've seen that.
One of the best things that's ever happened.
Dude, I feel weird sometimes, like, cause I also do live sound and shit on the weekends, besides all this other crap. And once in a while, I like, you know, take a video of the band because we can record them through our digital mixer thing, and then he could take it back and edit it and whatever, and then we could put the video on top of the audio, whatever. But sometimes, depending on the crowd, I'm just like, I don't want to sit here and like walk around looking. I feel like everyone is just looking at me, looking at the band, you know.
Oh yeah, I don't know. I think that you become invisible when people see that you're doing something. They just sort of filter you out. Like that's just a thing that the human brain does.
Yeah.
So,
yeah.
It's different than if somebody like a fan running on stage going, oh my gosh, like, of course everyone sees that, but like, you just don't notice like somebody that's doing their job. And like, it's not a big deal. I feel like, you know what I mean?
Yeah. Yeah.
Let's get invisible. Use my technique, man. Just pretend you're invisible. And then everything you do, you won't worry about it.
Yeah. True. I just worry about everything all the time. So I'm just like, constantly looking over my shoulder. But you're right, dude. It's like once you get past that's where the I feel like the art kind of takes control, you know?
Yeah, it does. It does. You can't let those, again, those, that's another reason, right? Like they're, we all have these reasons for things that we, that like for not living our dream or not doing something that we want to do. But like, think about the word reasonable. Like reasonable is a very like positive word, right? Yeah. But someone who has a lot of reasons is still reasonable. And those reasons, like if that's what you have is just a bunch of reasons, then you die with reasons. No one would want reasonable on their gravestone. Because you can have like, well, why didn't he, you know, well, why didn't that person pursue their dream? Well, there was a lot of reasons. Well, you know what? Let's just pretend that all those reasons are bullshit. And then we can go from there, because that's how you take responsibility for all the stuff that's stopping you. Right. So like when you say like, oh, I worry about everything, I'm that way too. I start worrying about too many things and I want everything to be perfect. But then that becomes a reason why I'm not getting good at something.
Exactly. So it's holding you back.
I try to notice like, what am I using? It's like using reasons for bad. Does that
opposite.
Make sense?
Yeah, exactly. It's like the opposite, and it gets you nowhere.
Yeah.
Yeah. Now, you you do a lot of shit now for, like I was reading, like, the clients on your website. Like, you got Comedy Central and Playboy and CISO and shit. Do you, were you the one that did Joey's CISO special? Like, you did photography
for
that?
No, I didn't do Joey's. The next thing I have on CISO coming out is, there's a show called The Guest List.
Yeah.
And I shot the opening credits for that. I did a really cool black and white portrait series of the comics.
Oh, cool.
And so that's like, I think it's 8 episodes, really good people in it. Awesome. And that's going to be, I think that comes out June, I don't know, like early June.
Cool, man. Yeah, I've been hooked on CISO ever since, like a couple months before Joey got on there. It's like, damn,
oh,
this
yeah,
is awesome.
Man, it's great. CISO is really great, and I hope they'll be around for a while. I know they're kind of
Troy, I'm sorry. I think you're you got headphones on?
Oh shit, wait. Maybe I covered up the mic. Sorry.
Yeah, it was covered up for a second there. Just a few seconds. It's okay. All good.
Yeah. All right, cool, man. Yeah, so but definitely check that out. Check out The Guest List.
Yeah, definitely.
It's a really, really great show. I do a lot of podcast covers and stuff like that, but you know, the main thing is I'm teaching classes. I just want people to get better, and I want people to learn what I know, because that's where photography's at now. Dude. A lot of people are sharing what they know.
Yeah, that's what one of the things I noticed about, like, going through, like, your pictures on Instagram, you, like, answer everyone's questions about, like, how you got that shot and, like, what you used to achieve that look and all that kind of shit. I think that's awesome.
Oh, dude, first of all, I love when people ask that, because that means somebody is actually, like, doing something. Someone's actually learning something on Instagram.
Yeah.
If I'm honored. When someone comes and says, how'd you get that shot? What lens did you use? What cameras you use, or what are your settings? Like, I'll tell you everything. I want you to know this. Like, I'm not only honored when people ask, I'm like, I'm excited, because that means that there's people out there that are not just like, oh, I'll just go and click like, and that'll be my life. Like, you know what? Learn something. Yeah. You know, but if you're following, like, I follow people, I ask them questions. I'm always trying to learn something, and that's what it should be about. And photography is very cooperative right now. It's a really good time, and I hope that spills over into a lot of other art forms. Like stand up can be a little proprietary. People don't always want to tell you how they're doing something. But you know, yeah. you listen to Joey Diaz, he's open book about everything.
Yeah.
He tells everything how he does what he does, and that helps other comics. And maybe we'll have, like, there can only be one Joey Diaz forever. Like, that guy is the most one of a kind that's ever existed in comedy.
Man. You're telling me, dude.
even, and I'm including, like, he's in that category of, like, like one-offs that'll never occur again, like Mitch Hedberg. You know, Carlin, like that. That's just like a perfect storm came together. But Joey just has sort of this. Joey has like the fact that he survived all the things he survived is sort of unbelievable. It's like he's the sperm that made it to the egg.
And, yeah, in life.
Yeah.
After the fact.
Yeah, exactly. So it's really inspiring. So yeah, I'm glad you mentioned that. I love when people ask me questions about how I got it or what I use, because I want people to know that stuff.
Oh yeah, man. And the Hall series that you did and you still continue to do, right? Like you keep adding people, right?
It's just had the 1 year anniversary. That the Hall series is in the. It's basically portraits of comics in the Comedy Store in the hallway surrounded by all these headshots, and it's shot with an 8mm fisheye lens on a mirrorless camera, and it gives a wraparound effect, so it doesn't look the same as it like a GoPro or something like that.
Yeah.
It's a much different feel to it, and so the Comedy Store has it up, has a gallery up. There's almost 100 prints up there right now in the main room as a permanent exhibit in the lobby, and we're still adding to that.
Yeah,
and
I cannot wait to get out there to see the Comedy Store, let alone that one hall, you know, just to see all those pictures, man, because I see a lot of them, but I'm sure there's some that like haven't made it to
Still have more to post. Yeah, May 10th was the 1 year anniversary of that.
That's awesome.
And I still have a lot more to post, and yeah, I probably now have about 150 paid regulars, and there's maybe like around 90 something up there right now. So there's a lot more coming.
Yeah, that's so cool, man. It's I've been into comedy for forever. Like my mom actually got me into George Carlin, like all his HBO specials when I was like 8. She's a real special lady.
Wow.
But and actually we got to see him too before he passed away. He played a high school near my house, man. It was like, it was so weird. Like I didn't even know that this particular high school, it's a couple towns over, but it's a huge auditorium. But I got to see him, dude. It was so cool. I mean, it was 99% of it was all like old shit that I've already seen a bunch of times, but just to see him in person do it, you know. Have you ever seen Carlin like throughout?
I got to see him. I mean, I saw him a couple times in concert, but I got to see him. I took my folks, they came into town from Phoenix. I took them to see I got to see him work out material for his final album.
No shit.
At the Comedy and Magic Club. And he would just go on. He was just on stage with a big yellow legal pad, and he would glance over at it, and he would work out this stuff. And it was very raw, but I was blown away by it, and I was laughing super hard. And here's a really funny thing that happened is there's a lady next to me. She looked really young. She had blonde hair. She had her sunglasses on, and she and I were the main two people that laughed on every beat. Like we laughed in unison, and like the crowd wasn't really giving Carlin what he deserved on these bits, but we were like right on point. We were like, "Oh my God, that's amazing." We were laughing. And after the show, my friend goes, "Hey, did you know that was Roseanne Barr?" I was like, "What?
Are you serious?"
So, yeah. I was like, that 20-year-old girl, like she just had, you know, she had sunglasses on and she had her hair dyed blonde. She looked young. So I didn't know until after the fact, but that made me feel good because it's like, hey, that's somebody. That was the second best sense of humor in the room. You got Carlin and you got Roseanne.
Yeah, right.
And, you know, and so it was so cool to watch him work stuff out. And then I got to watch, you know, that special that came out, which was what was it? It was had the word death in it.
Your,
I forgot what it was.
One of the last things he put out that actually just came out recently was
that just came out like six, like 4 months ago. Yeah.
Was that what you're talking about?
No. I can't remember. Anyway, it was the one that came out, you know.
I probably have it on my phone. I just don't want, hold on a second.
Yeah, it's killing me.
I hate when I can't remember stuff. I actually had, I was talking to Wheeler Walker Jr. I had him on the podcast a couple weeks ago.
Yeah, I saw that you had that episode. I can't wait to hear that. I love that guy.
He's hilarious. But he was the first person to actually ask me to like look something up as I'm like doing the podcast. I always have my laptop on the Wi-Fi turned off.
When I'm listening to a podcast, I get really upset when someone starts looking stuff up because then they, you know, then I feel like, hey, you know, look it up on your own time. Like people, I lose attention. Yeah. Anyway, yeah. So Life Is Worth Losing was the name of the special.
Oh, that's it. Okay. Yeah.
Life Is Worth Losing. And, you know, brilliant guy. It's always worth it to watch the master's work, you know?
Hell yeah, dude. I feel like I got to see that a couple times. I got to see Joey before this latest special came out, the Socially Unacceptable.
Yeah.
It was cool to be able to see what bits like actually made it to the special, which ones didn't, you know?
Oh, man.
It was awesome. He's the comedian that I've seen the most. I've only seen a couple besides George Carlin, him, and it's like saw Chris Porter last year. He's funny as hell.
Well, yeah, there's a lot of great comics out there, but Joey really is special, and I'm really glad you do all the stuff you do with Joey. Like, so he's just such an inspiring and real person that we just don't have anybody like that. And I'll tell you, this is a thing that I do when I go. I travel a lot, so when I get into a cab, wherever it is in the world, I always ask the cab driver, if they go, what do you do? Like, I'm in the comedy world. I said, yeah, who are some of your favorite comics? I always ask cab drivers that because I get like, I sort of get this like unofficial, it's like an unofficial poll of what's out there. Like, that's a real person, and that's like, you know, that's not, they're not voting online. That's I'm talking to a real person.
Yeah, just what are they particularly like? You know,
when I'm overseas, when I'm overseas, it's almost always Greg Proops. They love Greg Proops.
Yeah, he's big, especially in England.
He's huge. He's huge, but he's also like a really like brilliant and amazingly good person. But Joe, like I was in San Francisco recently, and I asked my Uber drivers, like, hey man, Who do you like? Who do you listen to? And he goes, I don't listen to a lot of comedy, but I was at a dark point in my life and I was ready to end my life. And my friend wanted to cheer me up and he took me out to a comedy club in San Jose. And I was like right there in the front row and I didn't even want to be there. And I didn't know who I was going to see. And then Joey Diaz walks on stage and he goes, he started talking about things that happened to me. He's like, I was in jail. I got a divorce. He goes, it changed my life. He goes, I got back on track. I'm now driving for Uber. I got another business. He's like, I'm really doing great now, but it's all because of Joey. And it's like, out of all the years I've asked that question, I've got some really cool answers, but I've never got one that impacted someone that personally and that deeply.
Wow.
And that's the power of Joey. And I bet you start lifting up rocks, you find people like that all over the place.
Oh, hell yeah, man. Just from being able, like, I started his Instagram page just a couple of years ago now, and I run it for him, and just seeing all of the different comments on there, dude, there's so many, and so many people will message him, like, you know, the private messages, but I don't read them all, but sometimes, like, you know, if I feel like they're like important, I'll like send him a screenshot of it and shit like that. But
nice.
You know, there's so nice. Many people with similar stories. He just helped so many people, and he got me off my feet too, man.
Oh,
honestly,
man. Yeah, like, no, he's done that for me too. Like, you know, and just sends those tweets out like, your balls are full of cock juice, and nothing's gonna stop you. It's Wednesday, like. Man, it's just like it does give you a little bit of extra step in the morning, you know?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, so that's why I try and, like, stay on top of it. That's usually my, whenever he does that, I'll see it, like, when I go into my bathroom break around 9:30, 10 Eastern time, and then I'll copy it and post it on Instagram, and so many people fucking respond to it, man. It's crazy.
Yeah.
Even more than Twitter, too. It's nuts.
When I post on my Troy Conrad's Instagram, and it's something, it's like a Joey picture,
mm-hmm.
like, it's the most, like, people go nuts. So it's so weird. Like, even if I'm posting someone more famous, Joey gets all the, like, people want to comment on it and people go crazy. It's like, people really love, like, it's almost like a perfect blend of celebrity plus cult following. Like,
yeah,
it loves them. They love the shit out of it.
Yeah, man. It's been cool. He actually, the way that we got in contact was through Twitter. It was weird. He posted right before Savage Dad came out. He posted a picture of him and Mercy walking down the sidewalk, and I took that and edited it on my phone and added the words and everything, and he used it for the fucking album cover. So I was like, yeah, so it's been a fucking trip, dude. It really has. And him and Joe Rogan, like, they share shit a lot, and I can't thank them enough, man. You know,
Joe's same thing, you know. Joe's like, he's such a good guy. That's why, and Joe's the guy who really, I feel like Joe Rogan and Doug Stanhope are the guys who sort of brought in the revolution at the Comedy Store.
Yeah,
you know,
yeah.
like Stanhope, like, I don't remember which came first. I think Rogan had sort of disrupted the Mencia thing, called out Mencia, and then I don't remember I don't remember which came first, timeline of this, but it's a combination of Rogan, who is a good guy to people, and Stanhope coming there and playing the main room at a time when the main room at the Comedy Store was empty, and Stanhope came in there. Brian Hennigan helped set that up, and Brian Hennigan's his manager, and it's sort of led to this, people being open to going to the Comedy Store. Now that place is, you know, three rooms are full every night for multiple shows, and it's pretty freaking incredible.
Yeah, man, I could imagine, dude. Like, I wish that there was somewhere like that on this side of the country, besides up in New York, you know. I think Philly needs something, or, like, if I keep telling the Comedy Store, whatever, like, I post something and they repost it or whatever, and like, whenever you're ready, I'm ready to run the East Coast Comedy Store.
Yeah. Well, it's the only reason that the Comedy Store exists, though, is because all those comics aren't here, right?
Yeah.
So, like, everyone's either in New York or L.A., and then you have San Francisco with some really good comics, but most of them are newer comics who are eventually going to move to the biggest, you know, one of the biggest two ponds.
Yeah.
You know? And Chicago is maybe starting to get a little better for stand up, but it's still like more of an improv and theater town. So, you know, New York and LA is your choice, and I'll always take LA because we have space here, and you can make your own project a lot easier and for as cheaply as free. Whereas in New York it's very difficult, like, you know. There's sticklers about film permits and stuff like that, and I think that just hurts. That's a fucking stupid regulation that messes up the economy.
Yeah, it's like the fucking the cooking union for the UFC or whatever. Wasn't that something like a problem, like some kind
of? Oh no! Wait, a cooking union
in New York? That's why, like, the UFC wasn't in New York for so long. It was like some kind of, like, some one of those unions that had to, you know.
Oh,
I'm pretty sure it was like a cooking union or something. Oh, like something weird.
Oh my god! Oh my god! It's so ridiculous. Yeah, that's the kind of stuff that, like, it ends up hurting artists. But and a lot of times it's, you know, it's these politicians who think they're doing something good, and they put in some regulation that just, like, you know, the fact that you got to, like, I remember in New York I was doing a 2-day film project. And one of those days was spent sitting in the New York film office waiting to pay $50 for a permit. And I had to be there like 6 hours. You have to like wait there. And it was just like such bullshit. So I lost. I could only shoot for one day. Like, that's the kind of thing that people don't see the result. Like, people don't know much about that. But you see it in less creative stuff out there because somebody, you know, somebody had to put up that red tape. Find a way to cheat that system.
Somehow, yeah. But you're right, though. You guys got a lot more room out there. New York City, if you're trying to film something.
Yeah.
Too, you know, so it's like...
So if you're familiar with Donald Cerrone, the UFC fighter.
Yeah, yeah.
He's my favorite fighter because he's tapped into how important it is to get your adrenaline going and feel that sense of death. And I love that.
Yeah.
And I try to do that. Everybody can do that in some way, like to find something that challenges them, that scares them, and then do it. So like when I'm shooting, I make sure I don't ever get bored. Like I had a shoot recently and instead of like, it was on Sunset Boulevard. We could have just gone down Sunset Boulevard and done all the shots at different locations and without getting in trouble. But I wanted the risk of getting caught. I wanted the feeling of butterflies in my stomach. And I wanted to we could get arrested. I had to check in with my client. I was like, you okay if we get kicked out? And like, you know, they write for something. She's like, okay, yeah, I'll do it. So we snuck into this resort and we just pretended like, you know, we were a family there visiting on vacation. And I have my camera stuff with me. So we really had to play it up. And it was a whole acting scene. We had to play these characters in order. We had to walk past like six security people. And,
oh, wow.
And it all worked. Like we did it and we got out of there without getting in trouble. But it was like breaking into Fort Knox.
Yeah.
I like the adrenaline you get when you're breaking into Fort
Knox. Fuck yeah.
You know?
Dude, I imagine that's the same kind of, well, not exactly, but like when you, like say for instance, when you first like got up on stage for the first time to do comedy, I can imagine that sometimes because I have the feeling that I would like to maybe, because I write shit. I don't fucking ever, I've never done it before, but I've been thinking about one day maybe gathering the balls to do it. But I can imagine it's the same kind of like, ugh, like scary, yeah. You know?
Here's how you do it. You just find what, you know, an open mic somewhere near you and you sign up for it. And then you haven't done it yet at this point, but now you sign up. Now you either post about it or you invite a few friends to see you. Now you have to do it. So that's when it starts is when you sign up and you invite someone. So now you're accountable for being there and then you start feeling the fear and, you know, but it's just taking that step, yeah. You know?
And that's the step that I'll have to take and then I'll keep doing it, but I won't invite them because I want to fucking work on that shit.
Well, yeah, you don't. After that, maybe you don't want to invite. That's fine. But that first one, that keeps you in the game. You know, have people there, and then they can always say, "Yeah, man, I remember seeing you first time," and you know,
yeah.
that's a cool story. So, you know, everything starts with having some way of being accountable for it. When I produce shows, I would start the show. Like if I wanted to create a new show, like I was doing this one man show called the Comedy Jesus Show, where I was Jesus and he would answer questions from the audience. And it was like kind of like an atheist Jesus, but it was like a PowerPoint on the mount. And it was this whole show. And it was great, but it didn't
awesome.
Start. I had to, it started when I wrote a check for the down to rent the theater. Like I remember putting $100 down to rent a theater. And that's when the show started. Like I didn't have it written.
Oh wow.
Before then. I didn't have the structure set in place. So, but once I rented that theater and I started selling tickets, all it's like, "Hey, I better write the show now."
Yeah.
And I did, and it became, you know, it went out on DVD. This is like this is 10 years ago now. It went out. I ended the show with this was anti-Walmart rant and about how to unionize Walmarts. And then But Walmart ended up picking up the DVD and selling it. only because they didn't watch, like, they don't watch everything. They just went off, like, what looked good, what sounded good, and it was, you know, people like it. So they were selling it, and they had no idea. I think they sold it for two or three years before they figured it out, and they took it off.
That's hilarious.
Yeah. But everything starts, but that wouldn't happen if I hadn't put that $100 check down to rent the theater.
Yeah.
You know?
That's true, man.
So
maybe that's what I should do, because I've also been thinking about, because there's not at all really any, especially in Jersey on my side of the river, there's no like comedy open mics. It's mostly music open mics.
Yeah.
Or open jams, you know, what they call it. People just get up there and whack off on the guitar. But
yeah, but creativity solves every problem. So what I had the same thing in Phoenix when I started. Most of the open mics were music. So, and I don't know how to play any music instrument at all. And if I did, I'd be terrible. So what I did was I had my set. I had my jokes. I went to music open mics and I did the jokes. And then in between each joke, I would just play the harmonica for 2 seconds.
That sounds like I could do that because I play guitar a little bit. So I could just go up there because I do an open mic every other week, but it's all music. We do the sound for it, but I get to play once in a while. So fuck
yeah.
I play like a stupid 2-chord progression in between.
Totally. Like that way I felt like I'm not infringing on and you know, and causing some sort of like precedent that now this open mic is going to be ruined by a bunch of like shitty open micers who are like, you know, like don't even care, and they're just gonna it's stage time, fuck it. And, you know, there are some people who are very self-serving and narcissistic, and they don't put the work in. They just I'm just gonna go up, I don't care if it's a music open mic. Well, no, you can't do that. So with the music, that just at least allowed me to have some fun. And they obviously knew that I couldn't even play the harmonica, but everybody in there enjoyed it. And it was one of those things that, you know, when you're starting early on, it gave me a nice boost. It gave me a good vote of confidence because, like, I was having fun with what I was doing. And they knew, like, at least he's, you know, it looks like there's music involved.
Yeah. At least it got you on stage, too, and got you that feeling of, like, you know, feeling a crowd and all that kind of shit.
Oh yeah, totally. It definitely, and it also taught me that, you know, that creativity can solve a lot of problems. Like, if I would have walked into that open mic and saw that it was a music open mic, I would have a good reason to say, I shouldn't do it, it's a music open mic.
Exactly.
But instead, I got rid of the reason and I just found a creative solution, and that's always available to everyone. It's just that we stop ourselves, and we stop ourselves at the reason. And again, then we go to the grave and we have lots of reasons. Everybody has a reason why they didn't do this, didn't do that, didn't start that business they wanted, or didn't ask that girl out. She probably would say no. Yeah, good. Well, good. You'll have a whole bunch of reasons when you die.
Yeah.
They'll keep you warm.
Jay-Z's going to have 99 of them.
99 reasons. That's exactly the point.
Dude, thank you very much for giving me your time, dude. It's been like an hour already.
Crazy. Thank you, man. Thanks for doing what you're doing, and I'm glad you're finding all this cool stuff to do creatively in the world and still fucking manage to have a good job out there, and like, so good on you, man.
Thanks, brother. It's tough, but it's fun, and I'm going to keep doing this shit, man. It's cool.
Yeah, dude. Remember,
to talk to cool people like you, so, you know.
Yeah, dude, remember, you have every reason to quit and not do creative stuff.
Exactly. Gotta find that reason. Right?
Everybody has a reason to stop doing the stuff that they love doing. There's always going to be a reason, but don't let any of that stop you. And thank you again for having me on, man. You're a good dude.
Thanks, man. You too, dude. And you can find you. You're Troy Conrads on Instagram.
Well, yeah, I had to add an S to my name. For the stupid reason. I thought someone else had it, and it turned out I think I signed up early on, and now I have to just I don't have that email anymore, so it might be. But anyway, so it's Troy Conrads with an S.
Are you on Twitter too?
And I'm and Twitter, I'm on everything else. It's just my name, Troy Conrad.
Cool, man.
But I, you know what? I don't know that any. I don't know why anybody follow me on Twitter. I mostly just am promoting my setlist shows and, you know, retweeting stuff once in a while. I don't use the only thing I really use in social media is Instagram. Yeah. I don't even use Facebook very much. But I'm gonna start because it's important. But yeah, you know what? Instagram, I will not let you down.
Yeah, man, you are on top of that shit.
Thank
and visit
you,
man. You at TroyConradPhotography.com.
Yeah.
Hell yeah. Get in on there.
Yeah, dude, man.
Thank you so much, dude.
All right, brother. Well, hey, we'll talk soon, but keep up the good work.
Thanks, you too.
All right, later.